You're listening to the audio production of The Name by Franklin Graham with Bruce Nygren, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Matt Baugher.
Chapter 1. Blasting the Name. "Christianity is a religion for losers," said one famous American billionaire. "Organized religion is a sham and a crutch for weak-minded people who need strength in numbers," said a famous American politician. "It makes no sense. What drives two such otherwise intelligent, motivated, and successful men to publicly slam the followers of the greatest name in history?" The wealthy man founded a television network, owns two sports teams and several ranches in the United States. He is an outstanding yachtsman who once won sailing's prestigious America's Cup. Time magazine once selected him Man of the Year, and he is generous in supporting favorite charities and causes. Even though he may apologize later, this man has a habit of bashing Christians. Why does a brilliant man like Ted Turner go out of his way to blast believers loyal to the name? Then there's the politician. As a young man, he valiantly served his country as a Navy SEAL. Later, he made a name for himself as a professional wrestler and actor. He has served as a volunteer for organizations like the Make-A-Wish Foundation. His entry into politics was as the mayor of a large suburb adjoining a major American city. In 1998, he shocked the political world with his election as a third-party candidate to the governor's chair. With so many outstanding credits to his name, why did Governor Jesse Ventura of the great state of Minnesota say that religion is just for the weak-minded? In recent times, it has almost become a requirement for the sophisticated and intelligent to take a swipe at the nearest Christian. A recent magazine article explained how to many of the culturally elite, the enemy of civilization is not terrorism, but instead religious believers of all types, including Orthodox Jews and Christians. Some years ago, I remember hearing how the then Secretary General of the United Nations, U Thant, spoke openly of his beliefs. On one occasion, he said, "I ever believe that the mark of a truly educated and imaginative person facing the 21st century is that he feels himself to be a planetary being. Perhaps my own Buddhist upbringing has helped me more than anything else to realize and to express in my speeches and writings this concept of world citizenship. As a Buddhist, I was trained to be tolerant of everything except intolerance." A friend told me that he once heard U Thant say publicly that all he had he owed to Buddha. I have no problem with allowing any person to express his or her views on their personal faith, this being one of the freedoms we enjoy in America. Can you imagine, though, the outrage that would occur today if someone in a similar position spoke as candidly about personal Christian faith? Maybe we should not be so shocked. People have been taking pot shots at Jesus for more than 20 centuries. Even one who has to become an ardent disciple started out as a skeptic. When Nathaniel first heard about the remarkable young carpenter from down the road, his response was, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Later, Jesus' own family members expressed doubt. Jesus told them that the world hates me because I testify that its works are evil. On another occasion, Jesus explained that those who follow him would face trials and persecution. He was right. As the centuries have rolled by, the name and its followers have encountered opposition. The 19th century atheist philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche said, "Jesus died too soon. He would have repudiated his doctrine if he had lived to my age." Nietzsche was so hostile that he wrote a book entitled The Antichrist, in which he said, "I condemn Christianity. I bring against the Christian church the most terrible of all the accusations that an accuser has ever had in his mouth. The Christian church has left nothing untouched by its depravity. It has turned every value into worthlessness, and every truth into a lie, and every integrity into baseness of soul." Others have been more or less acidic, but still critical. Mark Twain, with typical biting wit, said, If Christ were here now, there is one thing he would not be: a Christian. In the 20th century, the twin evils of Nazism and communism produced some of the name's most venomous foes. Adolf Hitler, who was a philosophic disciple of his fellow German Nietzsche, had some demented words of his own to describe Christians. "We are fighting against the most ancient curse that humanity has brought upon itself. We are fighting against the perversion of our soundest instincts. Ah, the god of the deserts, that crazed, stupid, vengeful Asiatic despot with his powers to make laws, that poison with which both Jews and Christians have spoiled and soiled the free, wonderful instincts of man and lowered them to the level of dog-like fright." Hitler, along with Lenin, Stalin, and Mao, denounced Christianity in advancing his demonic schemes and atheistic communist propaganda. Even entertainers joined the bashing. John Lennon of the Beatles made big waves when he said, "Christianity will go. It will vanish and shrink. I needn't argue with that. I'm right, and I will be proved right. We're more popular than Jesus now. I don't know which will go first, rock and roll or Christianity." Today, the Beatles have dispersed. Members of the band have stepped through the portals of eternity to stand before God in heaven. Overwhelmingly, though, the name of Jesus and what he taught and did, and insisted his followers do, continue to transform lives. The Apostle Peter reminds all believers, "If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name." Historian Philip Schaff described the overwhelming influence that Jesus had on subsequent history and culture of the world. "This Jesus of Nazareth, without money and arms, conquered more millions than Alexander, Caesar, Muhammad, and Napoleon. Without science, he shed more light on things human and divine than all philosophers and scholars combined. Without the eloquence of schools, he spoke such words of life as were never spoken before or since, and produced effects which lie beyond the reach of orator or poet. Without writing a single line, he set more pens in motion, and furnished themes for more sermons, orations, discussions, learned volumes, works of art, and songs of praise than the whole army of great men of ancient and modern times." One of the great military geniuses of all time, Napoleon I, wrote, "I know men, and I tell you that Jesus Christ is not a man. Superficial minds see a resemblance between Christ and the founders of empires and the gods of other religions. That resemblance does not exist. There is between Christianity and whatever other religions the distance of infinity. Everything in Christ astonishes me. I search in vain in history to find the similar to Jesus Christ, or anything which can approach the gospel. Neither history, nor humanity, nor the ages, nor nature offer me anything with which I am able to compare it or to explain it." Author H.G. Wells said, "Christ is the most unique person in history. No man can write a history of the human race without giving first and foremost place to the penniless teacher of Nazareth." Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, one of the greatest composers and pianists in all of history, said, "It is a great consolation for me to remember that the Lord, to whom I had drawn near in humble and childlike faith, has suffered and died for me, and that he will look on me in love and compassion." Alexis de Tocqueville, the French statesman, historian, and philosopher, observed, "In the United States, the sovereign authority is religious. There is no country in the world where the Christian religion retains a greater influence over the souls of men than in America. And there can be no greater proof of its utility and of its conformity to human nature than that its influence is powerfully felt over the most enlightened and free nation of the earth." President Theodore Roosevelt, one of the great populist presidents who with his swashbuckling style charged San Juan Hill explored Africa, and took the American flag across the globe, said, "After a week on perplexing problems, it does so rest my soul to come into the house of the Lord and to sing and mean it, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. My great joy and glory that, in occupying an exalted position in the nation, I am enabled to preach the practical moralities of the Bible to my fellow countrymen, and to hold up Christ as the hope and Savior of the world." After all these centuries, just why is the name so controversial and still stirring such a brew of conflicting passions? Answering that question is the single task of this book. It is important for you to know much about the name. This is not just another interesting spiritual topic. An understanding of the name is the key to all of life. The Apostle Paul hit the nail on the head concerning the Lord Jesus Christ when he wrote the following to the Christians at Colossae. "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." The Ted Turners, Jesse Venturas, and others who ridicule or demean the name and his followers must not understand what they are doing and whom they are dealing with. Unfortunately, the fence-sitters and even many who follow the Lord Jesus do not grasp the incredible scope and impact of his life either. That is why I have written the name. The name stands before, beyond, and after all others. In the beginning was the name. At the end will be the name. In the present time, all things depend upon the name. The name is above all names. The name will cause all knees to bow, Jesse's, Ted's, yours, mine, for all time. Do you know the name? Are you allied with the name? Your life or death depends upon your answers. How can any name be that important? Most of us do not think too much about names, ours or anyone else's. That certainly was my attitude toward my name for a long time. My family name arrived on American soil long ago by way of my Scottish ancestors, the Grahams, actually settled in the Carolinas before the American Revolution. Growing up, I did not understand or appreciate my family name. Since I was the son of a well-known preacher, people assumed either the worst or the best about me. The worst was that I was a pampered, spoiled brat. The best, that I was some sort of angelic being living by high standards no one could ever achieve. To be honest, I have never been an angel. If you asked my sisters, they would likely tell you what I really was growing up, a terror. Later in life, I became more aware that being a Graham and the son of a famous man might have an upside and a downside. The upside was that I was able to meet some interesting people and go to some interesting places. When I was 13, President Lyndon Johnson invited my father to spend the night at the White House. Daddy took me along, and guess what? I slept in the Lincoln bedroom. Since then, I have had the privilege of meeting every U.S. president. The downside of bearing my family name was people's unrealistic expectations. It was not until I was in my 20s, after fully committing my life to the Lord, that I took much more seriously the privilege and responsibility I had because of my father. I knew that if I did something disgraceful, it would not just embarrass me, but bring shame to my family's name that so many people in the world admired. When I began my ministry at Samaritan's Purse, I traveled around the world visiting the ministry's relief efforts. Everywhere I went, people approached me and expressed delight that I was the son of Billy Graham. Often
they were. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.